Now that all the men have their gifts for today, everybody go ahead and stand, grab the hand of your neighbor, and let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you today for the men who are here, for their ministry that's represented as fathering and fathers, Lord, some of them biologically fathers, some of them spiritually fathers to others. Lord, all of them with that potential and that capacity to display to others in this life what our Heavenly Father, God, looks like. And so, Lord, we thank you for them. We pray for them. God, we know that Satan is against that whole idea and against them being the godly representative, the representative of God in a godly way on this planet, and especially in front of kids and children who need to see that example. And so, Father, we pray that through this time today in your word, Lord, that you would instill in us through your scripture and infuse in us through your spirit, Lord, exactly the determination that we need to follow you in all that we should do as men. For we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated in the Lord's presence. Luke chapter 8. You know, as I thought about today, I started studying fathers in ancient Rome, especially during the time of the first century and New Testament times. And I discovered that fathers in the New Testament failed their families in several different ways. So the typical father in the Roman Empire handed his kids off to his wife and household slaves. And that a lot of that was prompted by the rampant immorality of married men in the empire. Maybe the most shocking example to me of how those fathers lacked affection, as it still is today, was their version of abortion. So those families that were in economic distress, they simply disposed of infants in order to prevent poverty for themselves. But since you're not yet feeling me like I need you to, can I give you an experiential exegesis of the failure of our fathers? And I want you to let me explore your experience for a second before we explore today's text, so I can explain why fatherhood failure was not just an attribute of ancient Roman society. Because first off, notice if you will, this is number one, all fathers fail when they lack affection. Let the whole church say affection. In his famous letter written in the first century BC, a husband named Hilarion writes his wife and he says, when you give birth, if it's a boy, let it live. If it's a girl, get rid of it. They lacked affection. Second, on the other hand, Roman fathers and fathers today fare no better, I think, with this second key ideal of fatherhood, because this is number two. Fathers fail when they abuse authority. Let the whole church say authority. Now, don't get me wrong, Roman society frowned upon the beating of children, yet they thought it was appropriate for the head of the household to beat the slaves in front of the children. We are the new Romans in American society, and so many fathers today were just like Roman fathers in that they were not only abusive, they were also controlling and power hungry. So third, we know both from ancient Romans and new, and this is number three, fathers fail when they have abandoned the children they have sired. So Roman fathers spent little time with the children that they sired. Their sexual liaisons with slaves and prostitutes were not considered adultery in general society, and so they had plenty of places to be besides their home. Earthly fathers who are immoral or absent damage early childhood development. So this Father's Day, I wanted to take up the topic of model fathers I have known. And I had a burden to do that because 43% of the children in America live without a father in the home. And what sociologists note is 90% of the homeless, 80% of rapists, 63% of young people who commit suicide, 71% of high school dropouts, and 70% of juvenile delinquents in state institutions grew up without being fathered. They grew up without the affection and authority of a father. Do it now, Dad, those things you ought to do. Don't wait until you're aged and this life is almost through. Do it now, Dad. Those tasks reserved for you. Those mighty and important things every dad should do. Do it now, Dad, before your children stray. Give them God's eternal purpose to guide them in the way. Do it now, Dad. Lead them to heaven's gate. Do it now, not later on. There is danger if you wait. Do it now, Dad. Do it while you can by showing them what it means for a boy to become a man. Do it now, Dad. And when you're at life's end, your children will say thank you for making them godly men. So if you're here and you're not asleep, I know just what you're saying. Look, Alan, I don't know who told you that I was going to be here this Father's Day. I know you were giving something away, so you probably expected some, you know. Some people that not normally here, but whoever it was that told you must be familiar with my story. Because sad to say, if I'm a dad, my parenting skills are no better than the ones I was raised with. But I can see what you're saying about the importance of fathers, because it's obvious from the dysfunction of our society that the dysfunction of our males has led us into a dysfunctional mess. And they have led us astray by simply leaving us to ourselves. So don't let me leave here till you show me who is the model of fatherhood I can follow to reclaim my role on this planet. I'd be glad to help you out. Give me a minute to unpack this passage. We'll clothe ourselves with this truth, get our healing. Head out of here ready to bring somebody with us next Sunday to see how the next thing we must do is grow. God has an eternal purpose, and fathers should be the leaders in that, since this is our thesis for today's study. A boy is the only raw material God can use to make a man. Dr. T. Barry Brazelton states, a father's involvement with a child increases their IQ, their motivation to learn, and their self-confidence. So he says, children with involved dads versus absent dads are more likely to develop a sense of humor and as well as have inner excitement. You know, there's much more to just being a father than being one biologically, because I'm talking about being a father emotionally, physically, recreationally, and most of all, spiritually. That is the significance of our Harvest Kids ministry every single Sunday, and our youth classes and their activities and their events. That's why we invest for your whole family to just take 72 hours away for our Get in the Word getaway at All Church Camp. Because William Franklin said, if he's wealthy and prominent and you respect him, call him father. If he sits in shirt sleeves and suspenders at a ball game or picnic, call him pop. If he wheels a stroller and carries diaper bags, call him papa. If, however, he makes a pal of you when you're good and is too wise to let you pull the wool over his eyes when you're not, then call him dad. And call him dad, because as I take you to today's text, we see a father every family ought to find. So anybody want to hear this, just say, give it to me straight, Alan. Okay, we'll do it straight with no chaser, because his name is Jairus, and as we meet him, we see that this dad has nothing else on his mind but his child. So to see what it takes to be a model father your family ought to find, then first off, notice if you will, this is number one, his disposition will reinforce his faith. As we examine this episode before us, we cannot avoid noting the disposition of Jairus as he appears before the Lord Jesus. It's both an impressive and important disposition because it reinforces his faith. Watch, verse 41 of Luke chapter 8. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet. So first note, and this is letter A, the importance of his position. Let the whole church say position. Jairus had an important position because he's ruler of the synagogue, but Jairus put himself in a position that displays his faith, because he physically falls down at Jesus' feet and verbally begs him to come help. As ruler of the synagogue, he's one of the most important people, most respected people in the community. All matters of social and religious importance rest in his care. He is a Hebrew of the Hebrews. That means he's got ideas, opinions, and beliefs that are antagonistic to Jesus of Nazareth, who's claiming to be their Messiah. All these facts of his position make all the more important, letter B, the impressiveness of his passion. Let the whole church say passion. Verse 41, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come into his house. This is how he reacted once he realized his beloved daughter is now sick unto death. In verse 42, Luke alerts us to pertinent personal details, for he had one only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a-dying. All we see is she's not just an only child, an only daughter, it's his only child. She's 12. She's dying. And most importantly, Jairus is her father. Jairus is ruler of the synagogue, but he's also her father. As ruler of the synagogue, his professional prejudice against Jesus causes him to delay. But as father, he knows what he sees and believes what he hears about Jesus. So he came and begged Jesus. And I knew I was preaching here today, and today's Father's Day, so I knew I couldn't be no lazy preacher. I'd have to go home and do my homework. So I performed an etymological investigation of that word besought in verse 41. And do you know, I discovered that that word is the verbal form of the noun that Jesus uses to name the Holy Spirit. So in John's Gospel, Jesus calls the Holy Spirit the Comforter, and that's the Greek word paraclete. And this word parakaleo means, let me hit you with this definition, to beseech Jesus means to make a personal call, to summons him to your side so you can present your case and convince him to act. That is what Jairus did. And in Mark's account, which we put on your handout, Mark 5, verse 23, it states, Jairus besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her that she may be healed, and she shall live. As ruler, Jairus regarded Jesus as dangerous, somebody to be avoided. But as father, he abandoned his prejudice, his piety, and his pride. And his faith reversed his disposition until his disposition revealed his faith. I'd like you to watch this short video slideshow of a couple of model fathers that I've known.
Louise and I met and sailed in 1954 with our little son, year and a half old, David. But then our Lord came to us, and he allowed the Simba Revolution of 1964 to break out. They swept across the land, pillaging and raping and murdering and destroying everything in their path. They separated us from our children. They swept in and burned all of our churches and seven schools and massacred 20 of our pastors and murdered hundreds of our Christians. And we were separated. Our children were back there trapped with Louise's brothers and their families. And we were out here, the two of us, at a landing strip, helping with the refugees. The next time that missionary came, he said, Brother Champlin, I don't know how to tell you this, but we've just gotten word that your wife's families, her brothers and their families, and your children have all been massacred. And our hearts broke. And we heard the voice of our dear Lord Jesus saying, do you love me? How? Will you give your children for the souls of these Africans? And somehow he gave us grace to look into his face through the tears streaming down our eyes. And we cried out, yes, Lord Jesus, with shoes on. And for a week they were dead to us. Helicopters came. We asked him, would you please look? He said, missionary, I'm willing to die for the living, but not for your family. They're dead. But after a couple of days, they said, draw some map and we'll look. And we watched them take off in three helicopters until they disappeared over the horizon. And later that morning, we saw those three little black specks appearing again, and at last they hung over our airfield and they began to lower, and we're almost afraid to look, and at last they're on the ground and the door swung open and our loved ones started climbing out. All right, you gave them to me. Abraham, you put your Isaac on the altar. Now you can have him back. The question comes again and again and again, beloved. Do you love me? How? Mom, do you love me? How? Young man, do you love me? How do you love me? We were evacuated then. He opened the field of Suriname, South America to us. It had been abandoned as a waste of time, men, and money, and we found out why when we arrived there in May of 1965. My blessed Lord Jesus asking one of his servants, do you love me? How? Do you love me? With shoes on.
Dr. Champlin passed last August and was buried there in the jungles of Suriname. Started his ministry in the Congo. And in the Congo, you became a man at the point at which you either killed an elephant or killed a leopard. And he killed both. And you can see in the lobby today some of the things they gave him, you know, some things before he left, and he had some honorary type things they gave him, but in the lobby is spear and shield and arrows, and then Brett was able to mount some Cape buffalo horns of a Cape buffalo he had killed, and you can see that out there. But I'd also like you to welcome another father, Daryl's son David and his wife Lynn. Will you come up, and Delana, come up with Lynn? So January of 64 was when the rebellion happened in the Congo, and they were forced out. May of 65, Daryl and Louise went to Suriname, and in June, David arrived back down, and Dr. Champlin spent 50 years in ministry there, and then passed last year. David met Lynn in 1975. And, you know, when David was here last April, we gave him an award for 40 years of ministry on the field. Gave him a Bible, gave him a plaque, and I knew that Lynn already had a Bible and she doesn't care anything about a plaque. So we missed your 40th wedding anniversary by 1 year, but we will give you a check because that's more significant. So thank you for being with us today. You can go ahead and sit down. You know, I don't have any doubt that many people criticized Jairus for his decision to put his shoes on, to leave his daughter's bedside, and walk down to the dock to see Jesus. But above everything, Jairus was a father. And any father would lay aside all his pride, all his esteem of himself. He would lay aside everything to do whatever he had to do for his child and reinforce his faith with shoes on. So to see what it takes to be a model father that your family ought to find, then the second scene in this story depicts how model fathers, and this is number two, act in dependence that reveals their faith. And based on the condition of his only daughter, he's moved to the point of desperate dependence on God. As a matter of fact, he is so dependent that he exhibits it in two ways. First, letter A, the lowliness he demonstrates. Let the whole church say lowliness. Because Mark's account tells us, you can see on your handout, Mark 5:22, and behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and when he saw him, he fell at his feet. Here's a man prominent, prestigious in the community. Here's a man who's been told Jesus is a heretic. Here's a man who was trained to believe that the Messiah would come as a military deliverer, not a spiritual savior. But here's a man who's also a father, and as a father, he's been nursing his little girl who's now at the point of death. So second, he recognizes, and this is letter B, how the lowliness he demonstrates is magnified by the willingness he displays. Why, just last week, he said, this is something he would never do. He would never lower himself to go see Jesus. And yet once a burly fisherman named Simon Peter said he would never deny the Lord Jesus, but he did. And once a man named Naaman vowed in great rage he would never wash in the Jordan River, but he did. And once Saul of Tarsus vowed he would never bow before that Nazarene. But on the road to Damascus, he did. And Jairus did not just bow, he fell down at the feet of Jesus. He came to the front, he knelt at the altar, he pled with the Lord. Why? Because he's a father. He wasn't talking about stillbirth or infant mortality. They had had her for 12 years. She was old enough to help her mother with the household chores in the kitchen. She's old enough to attend synagogue and understand what he's saying when he preaches. His willingness is now tested by great obstacles, because once he casts himself in desperate dependence on the Lord, immediately there's delay. Watch verse 42. But as Jesus went, the people thronged him. And a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him. So as soon as Jairus forsakes all in order to come to the only one who can heal his daughter, he is put on hold. He's put on hold while Jesus is called to minister to an older woman who has a hemorrhage. His willingness is tested by delay and then by denial. Jesus, she can wait. Jesus, she's not even dying yet. But my daughter, for my daughter, there can be no delay. And I know we always think so, but for his daughter, it was so. And instead of coming and touching his daughter, Jesus is stalled by a woman who touches him. And now the third thing that tests his willingness is doubt. Verse 49, while he yet spake, there cometh one from the ruler of the synagogue's house. Saying, missionary, I don't know how to tell you this, but your family's all been massacred. So Jairus stands there, stunned for a moment, and then just says, it doesn't matter now. She must have passed as soon as I left. Like many of our loved ones do, she waited until I was gone to depart. And now all hope is gone until the master speaks, verse 50. But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. Because a word from the master changes everything. And because it changed everything in Jairus' faith, the willingness of his lowliness was displayed through delay, through denial, through doubt. And now through derision, verse 51, and when he came into the house, he suffered no man to go in, save Peter and James and John and the father and the mother of the maiden, and all wept and bewailed her. But he said, weep not, she's not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn, knowing that she was dead. He encountered great obstacles, because that is what fathers do. He endured great opposition, because that is what fathers do. Nothing would thwart his determination to get his child in touch with Jesus. So I ask you this Father's Day morning, are you willing to do whatever it takes to get your children to Jesus? Are you willing to volunteer and put our harvest kids in touch with Jesus? There will be obstacles. Working with kids is not easy. We had to invent a take-two room just for those kids whose parents serve at 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock, or they go to an adult class plus attend a service. I mean, the kids of some of our adults are here from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. on Sunday, and when they act out, you give them grief. Why aren't you getting them to Jesus? Yeah. Almost 3/4 of our Harvest Kids volunteers and teachers have no child of their own in Harvest Kids. We need to pray that we will have fathers and mothers who want to take the training in July and volunteer to start working in August, getting their children and other kids in touch with Jesus. And I don't mean to be anything except encouraging today, because I know that our families are in the fight for their lives. But what they need most is not a roof over their head. They need the Lord in your heart. The greatest need is not material. It's not monetary. It's not physical. The greatest need is spiritual guidance. So in the final analysis, to see what it takes to be the model father that your family ought to find, this story depicts, and this is number 3, how his discovery of God revived his faith. Jesus did indeed come to Jairus' house, and in so doing, Jairus discovered God in a way that his faith was revived. Because first off, and this is letter A, he discovered spiritual power that amazed him. Jesus finally arrives on the scene. He turns all the doubters out. And then notice what happens next in verse 54. And he put them all out and took her by the hand and called, saying, "Maid, arise." And her spirit came again, and she arose straightway, and he commanded to give her meat. Her daddy has a reaction in the next verse, verse 56. And her parents were astonished. But Mark is the one who lets us know that it was an apoplectic, spastic reaction, Mark 5:42. They were astonished with great astonishment. A father who had once lost all hope now watches in amazement as his kids come off the helicopter. A father who was once let down is now lifted up. A father who was once in the depths of despair and sorrow is now revived and raised to the heights of bliss and joy. A model father who is willing to encounter great obstacles and endure great opposition now watches as his faith is revived and rewarded. Rapidly, the color comes back into the ashen cheeks of his young girl. Slowly, two eyes start fluttering open. And in the following amazing moments, happiness replaces heaviness, and peace replaces perplexity, and amazement replaces anguish. And Jairus, a father, witnesses the power of God through his son, Jesus Christ. The greatest thing your children could ever see is a parent waiting on the power of God. The greatest thing we can do for our kids is give them a model of godly adults who are willing to sacrifice to bring them before the Lord Jesus and watch as he touches their lives. Is it quantity time or quality time? No, it's a godly model. It's not a question of time, it's a question of giving them a godly model. So here's our first point for study. The spiritual success of our homes rests on the shoulders of godly men who are willing to be daring, diligent, and devoted models of faith in Jesus Christ. The heart of Jesus is longing for it. The heart of this church is bleeding for it. The hearts of our children are looking for it. And the hearts of our fathers ought to be living it. Jairus not only discovered a spiritual power that amazed him, but second, this is letter B, a spiritual priority that affirmed him. One father was willing to pay the price to get his child in touch with Jesus. Here's a man whose faith took all the risk and broke all the rules when it came to Jesus. This is the most serious thing I'll say this morning. It broke my heart yesterday to hear about little Caleb Martin. And we had prayed for him 2 years ago when he had the heart surgery to close the hole that was in his heart. And miraculous, God answered our prayer and healed him. When he was diagnosed with lymphoma, we prayed, and God gave him remission. And yesterday I was told that he's been discharged from the hospital with palliative care. And his parents have been told that at some point he'll go to sleep, and he simply won't wake up. We lose so much when we lose any one of our kids, but we gain infinitely more when they live again in Jesus. And Jairus discovered that when he made getting to Jesus and getting Jesus to his child a priority. You can kneel on the tarmac with tears streaming down your face. You can pray and say, God, I love you with shoes on. When you understand that it's a great loss to give up your child, but it's a greater gain when they live in Jesus. So do not spoil your children materially. Ruin them spiritually. There's nothing wrong with things as long as no thing takes the place of the main thing. Lead them, guide them, direct them to the things of God found in the Bible. You may not be able to bring your child to Jesus, but you can bring Jesus to your child. You can bring Jesus to your child by bringing the Jesus that's inside of you. And that, Dad, is the most important thing in this world. In 1989, there was an earthquake that almost flattened Armenia. A deadly tremor killed over 30,000 people in less than 4 minutes. In the midst of that confusion, a father rushed to his son's school, and when he arrived, he discovered the building had collapsed and been flattened. And standing there looking at what was left, the father was reminded of a promise he made his son when he dropped him off that morning. He said, son, no matter what, I'll be there for you. And as he thought on that promise and tears coming down his face, it was a hopeless situation. He couldn't take his mind off the promise that he had made. And remembering his son's classroom was in the back corner, the father rushed there and he started just digging through the rubble. And as he was digging, then other grieving parents arrived and their hearts were aching. They were saying, my daughter, my son. They tried to pull the father off and get him to go home, saying, it's too late, they're dead, you can't help. A police officer, a firefighter, both told him he ought to leave. To everyone who tried to stop him, he said, you gonna help me or not? And when they didn't answer, he kept digging, brick by brick. He needed to know for himself, is my son dead or alive? That man dug for 8 hours, and then 12 hours, and then 24 hours, and then 36 hours. And at the 38th hour, he pulled back a boulder. And of all things, he heard his son's voice. And he screamed his son's name, and his child answered back, Dad, it's me, Dad. And once the father finally got his son into his arms, the little boy looked up at his face and said, Dad, I told the other kids. I told him, don't worry, because I told him if my dad is alive, he'll be here, because he promised me this morning, no matter what, he'd always be there for me. And Dad, you kept your promise. Every head bowed, every eye closed, every Christian pray. Have you been there for your children? Are you here for our children at this church? Not everybody in here ought to work with our Harvest Kids, but I think everyone who has a child in this church ought to struggle with that question. We need to be a church that is there for our children and gets them in touch with Jesus. We do that through the Bible, we do that through teaching, we do that through Sunday school sessions, but they need to get in touch with the Jesus that's inside of you. They need to see the model of a godly man. Let's be the men that God has called and equipped us to be so that we can lead them in spiritual things. And before we pray, I'm just going to ask, if you're here and you're a man, let's reserve the front for the men today. And I don't always do this. Matter of fact, I don't often do this. But if you're here and you're a man and you would like to come up here to the altar and just pray and ask God to make you that model man, come up here right now. I'm not going to take long. We don't have long. We don't need long. You're a man. Either you want to pray or you don't. Either you can do it there in your pew or you can't. If you can, that's fine. There's not that much room up here anyway. You might as well just stay seated. But if you want to come up here and pray, then you come up here, you kneel down, and I want to have a word of prayer with all of us. And if you are here today and you've never trusted Jesus for eternal life, this is the day for you to do that, male or female, father or mother or not. All you have to do is pray and say, God, save me for Jesus' sake. All you have to do is put your disposition in position that displays faith in Christ's finished work. Not in church, not in priests, not in ceremonies, not in sacraments, not in being baptized, not being a member someplace, but faith simply in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross for you. And if you do that, then just pray and ask the Father to save you for the sake of His Son. And He will do that today. Everybody else, go ahead and stand and grab your neighbor by the hand. We may not be able to give our kids a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, but we can lead them to a mansion in the sky. Streets of gold and mansion in the sky. We can be the kind of father every family ought to find. Father, I thank you today for your word. I thank you for all the men in here today who have had an opportunity, Lord, to hear it, consider it. I thank you for the couples, the families in our church, the people who have kids, Lord, some of them single mothers. But Lord, I thank you for them. Each one of those children is precious. Each one of them is precious. And Lord, especially for that number of children, sometimes seems like a great number of children who do not have their biological father in the home, then Lord, what are we here for besides to stand in and give them the model of a godly adult, a godly father, to put them in touch with the Christ who's in us, to work with them, to pray with them, to minister for them? God, give us the motivation to do that. Make this a church that is going to be balanced in all areas in fulfilling our vision. So we're balanced in outreach, we're balanced in missions, and we are balanced in what we've got to do with our kids. Lord, make it so, because that is what will glorify you. That is what will please you and glorify your Son, Jesus Christ. And so we ask it today in His precious and powerful name. Amen.